Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics. I'm Bill Lacey, the director of the Institute. We're delighted to have you here tonight. I think it's our first program that we've conducted under a tornado watch, so I don't know if anybody was concerned about coming out because of that, but in the big storm a couple weeks ago, there was no damage to the building, so you're in one of the better buildings on campus, I think. Let me take just a moment to tell you a little bit about some of our upcoming programs. Today, probably some of you have heard it and some probably have not, but we today announced that the Dole Lecture, which is one of our three signature programs, will be held at the Lead Center on April 10th. That will feature former Senate Democratic leader Tom Daschle. That will be a ticketed event. The tickets are free. It's totally a free event, but you do have to get tickets at the Lead Center, and that will be on the 10th at 8 p.m. Two other events coming up that I want to ask you to hold the date on because they're events that you'd be very, very interested in. On April 13th, we'll have the inaugural Muncie Lecture on Journalism and Politics. That's a newly endowed lecture that, and this will be the very first one, and it will be very interesting. And then we also will be having a special guest here at the Institute on Monday, April 17th, and we'll be announcing both of those programs hopefully sometime early next week. We also have study groups that go on weekly. On Tuesday, our Democratic fellow John Tuohy has a study group on how technology and the entertainment industry are affecting politics, and he's going to have a very interesting guest on Tuesday afternoon at 4 o'clock. Senator Barack Obama's scheduler is going to be with us, and she's going to talk about what it's like to schedule essentially a rock star, because that's what Senator Obama is these days. And then our Wednesday study group is led by our Republican fellow, Alan Cobb. He is going to have a gentleman who waged the campaign against Kansasans against the bi-state tax, which was a tax for the stadiums a couple years ago that failed. And he will be coming the day after the big vote is held over in Jackson County, Missouri, about funding the two sports stadiums over there, and that should be interesting as well. And then finally, on April 15th, Tax Day, Saturday, April 15th, we'll be conducting a white glove tour of our archive. If you're interested in that tour, reservations are required, but again, it's totally open to the public, but please do call 864-4900 to make reservations. But anyway, we do have a very active and a very aggressive schedule of programming going on, and we hope that you'll take advantage of that. Tonight's program is going to be particularly interesting. We're very proud to have our guest with us tonight. To introduce our guest, I'd like to present our Associate Director for Programming and also a professor of history here at the University of Kansas, Professor Jonathan Earle. John, you can direct history too, can't you? Sure.
I'm thinking about it. I have some colleagues here who might not be very happy about me directing anything. Welcome. Thanks for braving the crazy spring weather tonight. It may be true that political, military, and diplomatic crises in Iraq, Iran, and North Korea have pushed Russia off the front page. But people who follow U.S. foreign policy know that our relationship with Russia is arguably the most important one our nation has. 15 years after the dissolution of the Soviet Union, Russia remains a major power. It retains a massive arsenal of nuclear weapons. The sharp spike in world energy prices have helped its economy expand significantly and given its government the resources to shape world events. And President Vladimir Putin, in addition to overseeing a slew of economic and structural reforms, has greatly intensified state control over Russian media and raised worldwide concerns over Russian civil liberties. Last year, Senators John McCain of Arizona and Joseph Lieberman of Connecticut introduced legislation urging President Bush to suspend Russia's membership in the Group of Eight major industrialized nations until it ends its seemingly ceaseless attacks on democratic reforms. And this past Friday, a 210-page Pentagon report suggested that Russian intelligence may have handed over U.S. battle plans to Saddam Hussein before the 2003 invasion of Iraq. If true, and this is not at all clear whether the claims in the report are accurate, Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, whose own policy background was in U.S.-Soviet relations, has asked her Russian counterpart to conduct an investigation into the matter. This is a disturbing development indeed. Some people, high-ranking people, have even suggested that the president send a message to Putin and boycott the G8 meeting in Russia this summer. Is it time to give up on Russia? To concede that its brief experiment in democratic freedoms is as much a part of history as Stalin's purges, I don't know. For his part, President Bush does not think so. Yesterday he said it would be a big mistake for the U.S. to boycott the G8 summit. I'll quote him here. "I haven't given up on Russia," he told Freedom House, a pro-democracy group yesterday. "I still think Russia understands that it's in her interest to work with the West and to act in concert with the West. Nobody is saying to Russia, you must look like the United States of America," end quote. Tonight, to discuss these and other Russian challenges, we have one of the nation's leading Russia hands. Paul J. Saunders is executive director of the Nixon Center, a nonpartisan institute intended to develop guiding principles for the United States' global engagement in the post-Cold War environment. In addition to being the center's chief operating officer, Paul Saunders is director of its U.S.-Russian relations program and is establishing new projects on energy and climate changes, U.S.-European relations, and the role of democracy in U.S. foreign policy. He's also a contributing editor to the foreign policy magazine, The National Interest. There are copies of The National Interest on the blue table where you got your programs this evening, published quarterly by the Nixon Center. Between November 2003 and January 2005, Paul Saunders served in the Bush administration as senior advisor to Under Secretary of State for Global Affairs Paula Dobrianski. In that capacity, he worked on a broad range of transnational issues, especially with respect to Russia, Ukraine, and the former Soviet Union, as well as Iraq, China, and India. Big job. Before his tour in Foggy Bottom, Mr. Saunders served as the Nixon Center's first assistant director and then as its director. He has written extensively for major newspapers and journals and is a frequent commentator in national media, including CNN, Fox, MSNBC. He is the author of America, Russia, and the Greater Middle East, Challenges and Opportunities with Jeffrey Kemp. It is my great pleasure to introduce our guest for this evening, Paul Saunders. Welcome.
Thank you very much for that very warm introduction, and I'm very pleased to be here actually on my first visit to Kansas. It's beautiful, and it's very nice to visit, and I wish it were a little bit less windy, but it's also in its own way very invigorating. So I'm very excited to be here. Before I start speaking, since I'm the executive director of an institution and I'm expected to make plugs for it whenever I can, let me mention just two things. We don't actually have copies of our magazine, The National Interest, out there, unfortunately, because I couldn't bring enough for all of you in my suitcase. But what I do have out there is a little stack of papers with a special subscription offer. This is actually the magazine right here, and it's a foreign policy magazine. It's a quarterly. We try to cover all of the interesting issues in the world, and I have five different pieces on Iran in the current issue. So anybody who is concerned about the Iranian nuclear program or thinking about that, we have a lot of insight for you. One other thing that I'll mention, I don't know if we have any graduating seniors or recent graduates in the audience here tonight, but the magazine also has a new editorial apprenticeship program that we're very proud of, funded by the Annenberg Foundation. And I have some information out there about that program, and we would definitely welcome applications from people here at KU. All of that being said, let me turn to my remarks. I picked the title, Time to Give Up on Russia, fairly deliberately, because I wanted to be provocative. You know, it's a difficult time in the U.S.-Russian relationship. I think that's clear to anyone who follows it closely. There's growing concern about Russia's domestic and international behavior in the United States, and especially in Washington. And many people are starting to ask, is this a country that the United States can and should work with? So I'd like to try to address that question tonight.
And I'll do it, I think, really in three parts. I'll talk a little bit about domestic circumstances in Russia. Actually, that's probably where I'll spend most of the time. Then I'll talk about Russian foreign policy and the U.S.-Russian relationship. And then at the end, I'll give my answer to this question, is it time to give up on Russia? Domestically, and Jonathan in his introduction alluded very much to this, democracy in Russia is weak, and frankly, I think it's declining. President Putin seems to be unwilling to tolerate any kind of serious political challenge to his authority. And, you know, in a certain sense, I think that lack of tolerance was understandable at the beginning of his first term because he inherited from Boris Yeltsin a very weak state, a very weak Russian state that was heavily influenced by very wealthy business people, pushed around by powerful regional governors. The policy process in many respects were for sale. Certainly some members of the parliament were for sale. And it created an environment in which I think it was clear to a lot of people that it was necessary to try to strengthen the Russian state. Putin's first two priorities were really to try to tame the business people who I mentioned. We call them typically oligarchs, those of us who follow Russia closely, and also the governors. And he did this in the case of these very wealthy business people primarily through intimidation and by making examples of particular people. And in the latter case, in dealing with the governors, actually through structural changes in the way that Russia is ruled, by taking governors who had been actually at that time in a situation where they were simultaneously governors and senators at the same time. And you can kind of imagine what that would do to American politics if we had a situation where people were governors and senators at the same time. But he split apart those two functions. And more recently, he has pushed through a reform in the way that governors are selected, so that now instead of being elected by the population of a particular region, they are actually nominated by the president, and then there's an up or down vote in the regional legislature. Unfortunately, I think Putin's effort to try to limit the influence of these various groups on the Russian government and to try to strengthen the Russian state hasn't really succeeded. And in my view, it hasn't really succeeded because he hasn't addressed in a serious way the root cause of the problem, which is corruption. And corruption in Russia is, if anything, possibly actually worse now under Putin than under Yeltsin. Certainly, when I talk to people in Moscow, that's what they tell me. And it's unfortunately, in dealing with a topic like corruption, it's difficult to get really good statistics on it. So we're limited in how we can form our impressions of what's happening. The upshot of this is that the state actually is still rather weak, despite the elimination of these other competing groups. And the Russian president, and I think much of the Russian leadership, is still very concerned about allowing any other group in the society to develop into an alternative base of power. And this has led to efforts really to subdue Russian political parties, to subdue the media, to subdue NGOs. I'll just mention briefly as sort of an illustration a story about one Russian political party, the Rodina faction. Rodina is, I'm sure most people don't follow it, I would call it a nationalist social democratic party. So it's left of center, and somewhat nationalist, or kind of national patriotic is the way the Russians often describe parties like that in its orientation. This is a party that the Kremlin actually played a major role itself in creating a few years ago. And the reason that the Kremlin did this was because they saw this party as an effective way to drain support from the Communist Party, which would be competing for essentially the same kind of left-of-center nationalist part of the electorate. The problem that the Kremlin had was that they were actually a little bit too successful. This party was led by a very ambitious young political leader, Dmitry Rogozin, who I think saw himself as a future Russian president and saw this party as his vehicle for getting there. And he wasn't really content to be kind of a political instrument of the Kremlin, as happens in so many situations, actually, when people try to create or to manage these kinds of processes. Last year, Rodina became a very major problem for the Kremlin. The Russian government was trying to get through the parliament a major package of reforms on Russian social benefits. In Russia, and actually still today, because the reform package wasn't successful, people who are retirees or veterans or disabled, they get a variety of benefits from the state, like free public transportation or you know, reduced prices or free variety of other services. And the Russian government was concerned that this was becoming too expensive and wanted to monetize these benefits and give people, instead of you know, free rides on the metro whenever they wanted, you know, $7 a month toward their transportation expenses. You know, I'm just picking $7 out of the air, but to give you kind of an idea of what they were trying to do. The people who this affected were quite upset about it, as you can imagine, and they were a part of the society that I think was very sympathetic to Rodina, and Rodina played a major role in leading protests that ultimately blocked this legislation from being passed. And I think at that point, the Kremlin kind of realized that they had created sort of a Frankenstein type monster that they couldn't really control, and they became very concerned about it. So what did they do? They banned the leader of this party from appearing on television. They started to harass local organizers for this party, some people actually even being quite severely beaten in some cases, and took a variety, you know, of other steps to make it very difficult for this party to operate. Earlier this week, they even, the Russian government seems to have successfully orchestrated a coup d'etat inside this party and has managed to get the leadership of the party to vote to remove Mr. Rogozin from his leadership post. So I think kind of a clear example of the government's intolerance of any potential competition for political power. You know, looking at the media just much more briefly, I already alluded to the fact that the media is very much under state control. I think that's much more the case in looking at national television channels. If you look at newspapers, especially in Moscow or something like the internet, there's considerably more freedom to express actually a very broad array of opinion, and some of it quite hostile to the Kremlin. The problem is that, you know, very few people are reading these media. So it's not too difficult for the Kremlin to allow this, because ultimately it's not a real threat. There just aren't enough people. It kind of allows the political class maybe to vent a little bit of its frustration without really having necessarily a big impact on the broader population. And then finally, you know, what I think actually is really most important in the long run, and getting back to this question of corruption, the Russian courts. The Russian court system is still very weak. There is a practice of the Soviet period that still endures today, which is known as telephone justice, and the name of it, you know, kind of implies what it is. If there's a politically sensitive case, you know, the judge gets a call, and then he reaches his decision. In commercial cases, that's less a factor, although certainly there are efforts at political influence, use of political influence in commercial disputes. But then, you know, you get back to the question of corruption, of threats, of bribery. And it makes it very difficult for the court system to perform the function that it should be really performing. You know, at the same time, often in the United States, there can be, I think, a great deal of excitement about political things that happen, political developments that happen in Russia that people try to use to make the situation look very bad, that may not be that significant, at least in my view. And here, I think a good example is a recent reform in the way that the State Duma, the parliament, is formed. There was great anxiety recently because President Putin changed the system from one in which half of the seats in the parliament were elected kind of like our House of Representatives from individual districts, and the other half were elected in a more sort of a European model by party lists. You know, there would be a list of candidates, and you would vote for the list, and depending on how many votes they got, they would kind of go, you know, five people down the list or 10 people down the list, and those people would get seats. And they would be national, you know, rather than being tied to a district. President Putin eliminated that system and moved to a system where there is strictly a party list. There are no individual districts anymore. And, you know, there were a number of people who were in the United States who were quite anxious about this, and this is a retreat from democracy, and et cetera, and et cetera, when, you know, this is clearly a system that I don't know, I don't want to say scores, but certainly a very large number of democratic systems around the world use. The problem isn't with the procedures. The problem is with the realities of Russian politics today. And, you know, kind of rearranging the organizational chart or these other issues I consider a little bit less significant. Having said all of this, and talking about how difficult the political conditions are in Russia today, you know, I do think it's very important that we look at it in the historical context of the period since the collapse of the Soviet Union, since 1991. I think this is very important because, frankly, I feel that the Yeltsin period was actually either deliberately or inadvertently misrepresented by both the government at the time and by the media at the time. This kind of legacy of perceptions of the Yeltsin period as kind of an ideal time, you know, when Russia was finally a real democracy, I don't really believe it's true, and I think it creates a perception, you know, that things were going really well, and now everything is really terrible, and it's all the fault of this guy Putin. My sense is actually that there's much more continuity than change in what has happened during this period. And I don't want to take too much time, but I am actually going to take a few minutes and try to walk through some of it and go through a little bit of the history of this period. I want to start in 1993. And 1993 was a year of enormous conflict between Boris Yeltsin and the Russian parliament, which at the time was called the Supreme Soviet. And the reason for this conflict was that Yeltsin, under actually considerable pressure from the United States and the International Monetary Fund and others, was trying to pursue a broad range of very radical reforms in Russia. Try to imagine if we had an American president who was trying to do Social Security reform, Medicare reform, welfare reform, health care reform, and, you know, all in the same year. Imagine what the politics would be like. You know, I don't think our system could handle it. You know, we have a hard time handling even one of them at a time right now. And there was an effort by Yeltsin really to do all of this at the same time during 1993. This led to a sharpening conflict because Yeltsin became increasingly frustrated. There was a constitution that was in place that actually gave the parliament quite considerable influence over what the executive branch was able to do. So Yeltsin's hands were really tied by the parliament. He was trying to do all of these things. He was under a lot of pressure from the United States and others to do it, but he couldn't. I'm sure a lot of people still remember how this was ultimately resolved in October of 1993. It was ultimately resolved by Boris Yeltsin sending tanks, you know, into downtown Moscow and firing shells into the parliament building where a group of parliamentarians had kind of holed themselves up and refused to leave, and forcibly disbanding the parliament. And this series of developments took place, and the United States government, after this took place, said, well, you know, this is unfortunate, but it's very important, you know, for democracy and reform in Russia, and we think that President Yeltsin did the right thing. So this is an event that had a very profound impact in Russia. That I think most people in the United States don't really understand, because we were saying that we were for democracy, and Yeltsin was trying to push through all of these reforms that were enormously unpopular, and which the parliament, you know, which represented the people really to the same extent that Yeltsin did, rejected. And instead of kind of working and finding a compromise like a democratic system would, there was a decision to disband this parliament by force. After that decision, Boris Yeltsin very quickly wrote a new constitution in the space of about 2 months. And that constitution was approved in December 1993. In a vote that some people have raised questions about subsequently, about the legitimacy of the voting. And it was a constitution which, unsurprisingly, created a very strong presidency and a rather weak parliament. The United States at the time thought that this was really terrific, because now Yeltsin would finally be able to do all of these things that we wanted him to do. So, what did Yeltsin do with his new powers? He started a massive wave of privatization, you know, selling off all of these enormous formerly Soviet state enterprises, mostly to people who were well connected to the government, or in some cases, I think even to people who were in government, who were perhaps the best connected. And again, something that was very unpopular domestically. And this is happening in a situation where the Russian government has a very tight budget, and where government employees and retirees who were receiving the Russian equivalent of Social Security checks haven't gotten their checks for 12 months, 18 months, a very long time. So we have on one hand that happening, and on the other hand this government kind of dividing up the spoils of the Soviet system among people who were close to the government. Now, the people who bought these companies really quickly figured out that a very good investment for them with their new resources was to buy television stations and newspapers. And they started kind of crazily attacking each other and attacking the government. And all of these media entities, you know, they were very free in the sense that, you know, you could read almost any opinion that you could imagine reading, you know, in the newspaper, or you could see it on television. They were free from government control. But they weren't really free in the sense of being free from the people who owned them. And the people who owned them had very narrow interests, which were mostly centered around, that auction was unfair and my company really should have won the bidding for this company rather than that other guy's company. You had kind of this crazy system. This went on for a couple of years, and we get to January 1996. And in January 1996, the presidential election in Russia is 6 months away in the summer. And Boris Yeltsin has a 3% approval rating. 3% approval rating. So the group of people who own all of these companies that they have bought through various different means in auctions and other ways from the Russian government, they pretty quickly realize that if there's a change of leadership, it could be a very bad thing for them. They could lose these companies, they could lose all of this wealth, it could all go away very quickly. So they take these television stations and newspapers that they have, and they basically turn them over to the committee to re-elect Boris Yeltsin, if I can put it that way, to such an extent that there was one particular individual who was simultaneously an official Yeltsin campaign advisor and the number two executive at one of these companies. Something that, you can't really imagine, like, the chief operating officer of NBC News, being a paid Bush campaign advisor or Kerry or whomever else campaign advisor. But this is a situation that we had in Russia. We also had a situation where the United States was quite concerned that Boris Yeltsin would lose because we had this new partner who had very limited resources and was very dependent on us and was quite willing to be flexible on a lot of foreign policy issues as long as they would have our votes on the board of directors of the International Monetary Fund. And in April of 1996, the IMF voted to give Boris Yeltsin, to give Russia, a $10.1 billion loan. And after getting this loan, you can kind of imagine Yeltsin went on a little tour around Russia and he visited with every governor and, I'd really like to be reelected and I'd really appreciate your help. And if everything, works out well, there are a lot of projects that we could fund in your region. You can kind of see how that would play out. So Boris Yeltsin wins re-election, and the United States government and a lot of people in the media say this is a great triumph of democracy, and we're so excited and pleased that Boris Yeltsin has won re-election. When, in my view, how democratic the procedure was with a media that was totally excluding the opposition, and with the government that was basically using the state treasury as a way to buy support around the country is open to question. Now, I don't want to spend too much time on this, but, and I'm sorry for doing it, but I think that it's valuable because I think it gives us a sense of perspective. So I'll just be very brief in getting us a little bit closer to now. Yeltsin gets reelected. There's another round of privatization. There's another round of massive competition between all of these different companies. There's a huge financial crisis in Russia that some people may remember in 1998 with a massive devaluation of the ruble. Yeltsin loses really most of the political support that he had rebuilt and loses a lot of his kind of political authority. He starts to become ill. There are long absences from the Kremlin where he's sick. And eventually he decides to resign from office 6 months early before the next election. And he decides to resign from office because this allows his prime minister, Vladimir Putin, to become the acting president. And Mr. Putin becomes the acting president, and then he has 3 months to organize a new election. And, you know, when you're the acting president and you're in Russia and it's your job, you know, to organize an election, you know, it turned out in a fairly predictable way. But still after this process, you know, there were a lot of people in the United States who were saying, this is really great. You know, this is really terrific. You know, Boris Yeltsin, we loved him. He was a great hero, but, you know, he was getting kind of tired and less effective there towards the end. And now we have this young, dynamic person who's going to pursue this very aggressive reform agenda that we want, but he's going to do it so much more effectively, and he's going to be so much stronger. And, well, you know, guess what? That's what we got, and that's what we have. So I wanted to go through all of this, you know, kind of for three reasons. One, for two reasons. One, because, you know, as I said, I think it demonstrates there's a lot more continuity in this time period than most people really admit. Secondly, you know, we have a certain share of responsibility for how this situation turned out. And, you know, I don't want to say that we have a lot, because the people who have a lot are the people in Russia who did it. But to the extent that we had an opportunity to play a role in this process and to demonstrate to people in Russia that we support kind of actual democracy rather than just talking about democracy, I think our policies failed. I guess, you know, if you wanted to look kind of at a broader message, and I'll return to this a little bit, you know, promoting democracy is a very difficult thing and a very complicated thing. And I think the experience of the 1990s, I hope, will illustrate to us, you know, that it's a lot harder than we think, and maybe we need to think a lot more carefully if that's the kind of thing that we want to engage in as a foreign policy. Now, shifting from the Russian domestic scene to international affairs to Russian foreign policy, it's also an area where there's growing concern, I think, among many people in the United States. John mentioned in introducing me this question of the potential Russian sharing of intelligence with Saddam Hussein, and I think I would also share his approach of reserving judgment on that until there's been a real investigation into it. The reports are a little bit confusing, and there are some parts of the military that are producing the report and other parts of the military that are refusing to confirm the authenticity of the documents, and it gets very confusing. So I think we'll have to see how that plays out. But certainly there are a number of questions that people have about Russian foreign policy. Now, after September 11th, of course, President Putin was actually the first leader in the world to call President Bush. He was the first leader in the world to call President Bush. He expressed his sympathy, his support, and his willingness to help. And it began a period of really unprecedented cooperation between the United States. There was very substantial intelligence and counterterrorism and other collaboration in bringing down the Taliban regime in Afghanistan, which the Russians had also actually despised for quite some time for their own reasons. Unfortunately, after that real success of cooperation, you know, there was not really an ability to broaden that, to build on it, to do more with it. And, you know, we had a shared sense that Al-Qaeda was a problem for both of us, but, you know, the rest of our definition of what terrorism was in the world, there were a lot of differences. There were differences in the Middle East, there were differences in Chechnya, and it made cooperation somewhat difficult. The relationship also on the foreign policy side slid a little bit over the confrontation and eventual invasion of Iraq. Russia was very opposed to U.S. military action against Iraq, basically arguing two things. One, they said, you know, we don't like Saddam Hussein, we think he's a terrible guy. But, you know, removing him from power could really destabilize Iraq, and it could destabilize the region, and we think it would be a mistake. The second argument they made was that, you know, we agree with you that Saddam Hussein probably has weapons of mass destruction, but we think the appropriate way to deal with that problem is by, you know, continued negotiations and let the diplomacy go on a little bit longer. We obviously had a different view the administration had a different view. And, you know, there was definitely some disruption in the relationship, although eventually I think even by the end of 2003, both governments kind of realized that they needed to find a way to work with each other. Today, there are a lot of people who are disappointed that Russia hasn't done more with North Korea, that Russia hasn't done more with Iran. There are a lot of people who are quite concerned about Russian behavior in the former Soviet Union, that Russia is trying to reestablish some kind of empire, control, domination, influence. There are different ways that it's described, that Russia is propping up undemocratic leaders because they're friendly to Russia, and that's something that we don't like. Finally, there's a lot of concern on the foreign policy side about Russia trying to use its vast energy resources as a political weapon. And we saw that most recently in January of this year. For people who were watching, there was a dispute over the price of gas between Russia and Ukraine. And the Russian government, after actually several months of this dispute, decided that they were going to show the Ukrainians, you know, who was in the driver's seat, and they turned off the gas. And this provoked a very negative reaction in Europe because actually the gas pipeline, it served both Ukraine and Russian gas customers in Europe. And the Russians, when they turned off the gas, they didn't actually turn it off. They just turned it down, so that there was enough gas going through so that if all of it went to Europe, it would be enough for their European customers. But, you know, unsurprisingly, not all of it made it to Europe. And this created a lot of distress in Europe. It was in January. It was a cold winter. There was a lot of anxiety about would there be enough gas. And it kind of crystallized, really, fears that people have had for a long time about Russia and its energy resources, because Russia, crystallized for people in Europe and the United States, because Russia has often engaged in this kind of behavior with its neighbors, but it hasn't really had an impact on people outside of the region previously. Now, looking ahead at the U.S.-Russian relationship, I don't want to sound too bleak, because I was fairly bleak already on the domestic side. But looking ahead, actually, over the next 2 to 3 years, I have to say that, honestly, I think there are a variety of dynamics in motion that are likely to further weaken the relationship. I see it, at least over the next 2 to 3 years, getting worse rather than better. And I think there are two main reasons for that. The first reason is this question that I mentioned about Russia's neighborhood. One of the things that President Putin did when he decided that he wanted to help the American government to oust the Taliban was to acquiesce in having American military bases in Central Asia. And, it's not like we needed his permission or anybody else needed his permission. You know, we're a sovereign country. The countries in the region are sovereign countries. We're entitled to make their decision, you know, our decisions on our own. But, you know, at the same time, if Russia wanted to be really upset about that and create problems because of that, they could have, and they didn't. And, you know, the key element, I think, in Putin's willingness to go along with having the bases there was that they were explicitly tied to American military operations in Afghanistan. They're not permanent bases. Once the operations are done, the bases would go. You know, that was obviously probably about 4.5 years ago now. And while I'm sure that President Putin didn't expect the war in Afghanistan to be over instantly, at the same time, I'm not sure that he expected to have American military bases in that part of the world for almost 5 years. Who knows what he may have thought or not thought. At the same time, though, you know, the conflict is obviously ongoing, and to the extent that we have forces there in Afghanistan, we need to have bases to support them. Russians have also been very concerned about revolutions that happened in the last few years in Georgia, in Ukraine, and Kyrgyzstan. And there is a widespread perception in Russia that those were sort of orchestrated by the United States to put pro-American governments in power in this region that's very important to Russia. And I think there's a broader concern linked to that the Bush administration's really central foreign policy priority today, promoting freedom and democracy, is going to mean kind of more of the same in this part of the world. I was in Moscow actually just about 6 weeks ago. We do at the Nixon Center a U.S.-Russian dialogue program, and we sent a small group of people, seven people actually, led by Brent Scowcroft, the former National Security Advisor. And we met with a number of people in Russian think tanks. We also met with a number of senior officials in the Russian government. You know, this was the number one issue that people kept coming back to over and over and over again. The U.S. Activity in this area that they regard in as their neighborhood. What are our intentions? Why are we doing this? It's very damaging for them. To them, they feel if we destabilize their governments in this region, trying to put in different, more democratic governments, they view it even as hostile to them if we destabilize and replace a government that's friendly to them with one that's friendly to us. You know, some of the discussions on this topic, they got a little bit over the top because it's an issue actually that many people in Russia quite emotionally. But, you know, there was one official in the Kremlin who essentially was accusing the United States of facilitating efforts by another government in the region start a war in a part of that country where there are a lot of Russian citizens who live, and they were very worried about that too. The problem with our engagement in this region, and I alluded to it already, is that I think a lot of people, both in terms of Russian public opinion and in the Russian government, have a hard time understanding our policy in Central Asia without seeing it as hostile. It's almost inherently hostile. And it's creating a dynamic, in my view, where people in Russia are shifting from disapproving of American policy to being hostile toward American policy. I certainly view that as a very negative development. The other problem with these discussions of this part of the world is we're still really talking past each other. There's not an ability to find a common language. You know, the people from the U.S. government go and they say, you know, we want to promote freedom and democracy in this region. We want to help these people to have prosperous, you know, more prosperous economies and better lives and better futures. And all of these things, and you know, then the Russians kind of come back at us. You know, we want this region as our neighborhood. We want this region to be stable. When there's instability in this region, it threatens our interests. It threatens even some of our citizens who live there. It creates an environment where terrorism, where drug trafficking, where all of these other things. Are more easily achieved, and we also don't understand why you're doing it, because we don't think that you're really promoting democracy. We think you're promoting pro-American governments. The second real problem that I see emerging in the U.S.-Russian relationship, actually I think it's already emerged in the U.S.-Russian relationship, I think it's going to be more of a factor over the next 2 to 3 years, is Russia's growing confidence and assertiveness. We actually had a little discussion on precisely this issue yesterday in Washington at our office. Russia today, overwhelmingly, in my view, because of high oil prices, is in a much different position than it's been in years past. The hard currency reserves of the Russian Central Bank are up to $200 billion. The Russian government established a stabilization fund actually just about, I think, a year and a half ago. They've already put $50 billion into that fund from the oil wealth that they've been bringing in. The IMF loans that I mentioned to you that on which Russia was so dependent in the 90s, they're now paying back ahead of schedule because they have all of this money. At the same time that they're collecting all of this money and have so many more policy options because they have this money, they're also looking around the world and they see in the United States, people who are very alarmed about our dependence on the Middle East for oil, and to them, it seems like they're willing to go, you know, to do almost anything, you know, to get oil from someplace else. I think they see some of the same dynamics at work in Europe. There are a lot of commentators in Russia now who describe their country as an energy superpower. There's this concept that, you know, maybe we're not kind of a global competitor, you know, to the United States anymore, but, you know, we do have these massive energy resources, and finally, you know, we have something that's going to put us in a position where we can talk equally to the Americans. and they can't push this around. So this is leading Russian officials, you know, to be, as I suggested, much more confident and I think much more assertive in their foreign policy behavior. I think the United States is not really prepared to deal with a more assertive and confident Russia at this point. And therefore, what I think is likely is that we're going to see this very assertive behavior simultaneously with disturbing domestic conditions. And it's going to lead probably most people in the United States to think that this is not a very useful or constructive relationship for us, and we need to take a different approach to it. I think it's also really important to remember, you know, there's kind of a third factor, and I'll just, I can actually say it in two words, 2008. There are going to be presidential elections in the United States in November. There are going to be presidential elections in Russia, actually a little bit earlier than that, in the spring. And you're going to have politicians in both countries who are kind of competing to be, in Russia, the person who can really stand up to the United States, and in the United States, you know, the person who's finally going to get tough on those Russians and show them how much we're committed to helping them live in a free society. So now we get to the question that I asked with the title. You know, is it time to give up? And all of this is very bleak, I think. The situation in Russia, inside Russia, is bleak. The situation in the relationship is bleak. But actually, no, I don't think it's time to give up. I think that this is a very important relationship to the United States, that we continue to have a great deal in common, and particularly in the areas of energy, terrorism, and nonproliferation, which are kind of routinely cited. There are a lot of real opportunities for both of us. At the same time, I think if we do give up and we kind of allow the relationship just to go into this slide, I think we're also going to find that there are some real costs to that. And, you know, no, I don't think there's going to be another Cold War. Russia, as much money as they have now, they can't afford it. I was listening to someone yesterday who was telling me that the Russian defense budget is 5% of the American defense budget right now, not counting all of the supplementals for Iraq and Afghanistan. So, you know, it's not a military that can compete with the United States. It's not an economy that can compete with the United States. It's not a global leader that can compete with the United States. At the same time, there are a lot of things that Russia could do that would be quite inconvenient for the United States and would be quite unpleasant for the United States. The United Nations Security Council is one place where a lot of that could happen. There are, however, some people in the current administration who don't think that's a place that we need to worry about. I think it's a place we need to worry about. But, you know, even if you set this aside, there are a lot of other ways that Russia, if it actually believed the United States were a hostile power, there are a lot of things that Russia could do with Iran, with almost anybody else in the world who also doesn't like the United States, that would be very inconvenient for us. Finally, you know, there are unintended consequences. And I mentioned already probably 15 minutes ago one of the unintended consequences that we already have in Russia, which is having Vladimir Putin in power with a constitution that makes him a very powerful person. Let me give an illustration of another maybe potential unintended consequence that we could already have experienced. And, you know, I don't want to over-dramatize this, but I think it's important to think about. In 1999, President Putin came to President Clinton, and he said, "We are very concerned about the Taliban regime in Afghanistan. We're concerned because it's an unpleasant regime. They're harboring terrorists. These terrorists are going to Chechnya. They're contributing to our domestic problems. We would like to work with you together to do something about the Taliban." The Clinton administration response to that was that, no, we don't want to work with you to do something about the Taliban because we don't want to legitimize what you're doing in Chechnya by allowing people to link that to a struggle against terrorism, because we don't believe that's terrorism. We believe you're doing all of these terrible things, and we don't want to work with you because of that. Now, who knows how that could have played out, you know, over the course of the 2 years after 1999, if we had been willing to do that. I have no idea. And, maybe we would have talked and talked and talked, and we couldn't really agree on something that we both wanted to do. Maybe we would have agreed on something that we wanted to do and it wouldn't work. Maybe we agreed on something to do and did it, and it didn't work quite in the way that we intended. But there is, at least intellectually, a theoretical chance that if we had taken that step and worked with Russia and supported, the idea was to support the Northern Alliance, to use that support for the Northern Alliance to destabilize the Taliban government. Who knows what position al-Qaeda would have been in 1999, in 2000, in 2001, and what kinds of things they would have been able to plan and do. And again, I don't want to over-dramatize it. I don't want to oversell it. But I think when we start thinking about, different courses of action that we can take in the world, we need to think not just about what we want to do and about what we hope to achieve, but also about all of the things that can go wrong and, again, the unintended consequences. I think that's actually one of the most important things that we could start to do in our foreign policy that would make a contribution. I also think that it's worth trying to continue pursuing a constructive relationship with Russia, because I actually don't think that we have any really fundamental foreign policy differences. We definitely have some serious or even important foreign policy differences, but we don't have fundamental foreign policy differences in the sense that there is not anything that we want or that Russia wants that inherently has to be damaging to the other. If we kind of talk even, I think, about Central Asia, it's going to take a long time and it's going to be very hard. But I think there's a way, if both sides are willing to go a certain distance, to get around that. And that kind of leads me really to my last point. And I think our biggest problem in dealing with Russia actually is a problem that we have in dealing with a lot of other countries and not just Russia. It is getting the United States government to acknowledge that other governments around the world have different perspectives from the American perspective. And, we can disagree with those perspectives, and in a lot of cases we should disagree with those perspectives. But people are entitled to have those perspectives. And I think that this has really been a problem actually for both of our post-Cold War administrations, for the Clinton administration and for the current administration, there's often been an assumption, you know, that the United States won the Cold War. We've kind of figured out how society should be organized, how the world should be organized. And, you know, we're going to come and we're going to explain it to you. And you might not agree with it at first, but if you listen to us, you know, long enough, you'll get the message. And you'll agree that we're right. And, you know, then we can all be friends. And I think this is really a wrong-headed approach to foreign policy. I don't think it works between countries. And as I was saying over dinner before we came out here tonight, I don't think it works between people. You know, try to imagine if you went home at night to your husband, wife, girlfriend, boyfriend, parents, children, whomever, you know, and took this kind of approach in dealing with them. It's not a way that you can have a sustainable relationship with anyone who is not totally dependent upon you. Russia, I think, certainly does not feel at this point that it's totally dependent on us. So, you know, really, I guess my final point is, you know, we've got to have a much greater sense of humility in our foreign policy. Getting back to the question of promoting democracy and how we tried to promote democracy in Russia. You know, unfortunately there are a lot of people in Russia who actually think that was also hostile and that it was a deliberate effort to weaken the country. I don't believe that. I think it was done with the best of intentions. You know, but we have a saying about, you know, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And unfortunately, I think, you know, it's not the nobility or morality of our intentions that count in the end. What counts in the end is the morality of the result and what the situation is actually on the ground after we try to go and do whatever it is that we want to do. And if I think if we approached our foreign policy again, you know, both towards Russia and also more broadly, with a little bit more of this appreciation of how complicated the world is and a sense of responsibility for the consequences, including the unintended consequences of decisions that we make, we would have a much more successful foreign policy and a much better leadership position in the world. So there it is. I hope I didn't go on too long or put anyone to sleep. And I would be very happy to take your questions. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Saunders, to go back for just a moment to the part of your talk.
Yeah. Right. You mean the oligarchs and the governors?
Arrested and sentenced and imprisoned is writing essays and having them distributed even to some degree in the press under the title of A Turn to the Left, number one and two, where he's advocating a return to some of the more liberal reforms of the earlier post-Soviet period. So is there any reason for optimism in the future on your part on the influence that might be brought to bear, not just on Putin or his successor, but on Russian politics in general, by, you know, the question of corruption aside,
right,
on what happens in Russia from the oligarchs and from the regions?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll answer that kind of in two ways. The first way is a very broad point. And very broadly speaking, I think that any kind of a pluralist system that allows for more input into the policy process and even creates some constraints on the policy process is a net plus. You know, President Bush talks about democracy being a good thing for America because he says that democracies don't fight each other and this makes the world safer. I have a different view, actually. I agree that democracy is a good thing, but I have a different view about the mechanics of how it works. And we actually, if I can plug the National Interest again, we had an article in the Journal, I think one or two issues ago, by a couple of distinguished political scientists who looked at this question of democracies and war. And they said, well, actually, you know, mature democracies don't fight that many wars, but countries that are kind of in the process of becoming democracies tend to fight a lot more wars. I'm not sure that's the direction that I would look in. What I think is much more important, and what I tried to say a little bit already, is having a system where you have checks and balances, where you have a leader who can't just sit in the Kremlin or in the Forbidden City or in wherever else it is that they sit. And make these decisions by themselves or with their two or three closest aides and friends. But you have a system where, you know, you make a kind of a proposal for a policy that you want, and you have to get different constituencies, you know, to agree to that before it can work. And there are a lot of different ways that a system like that can be designed. I think, broadly speaking, they tend to fall under the category of being democracy. That's why I think having democracies is a good thing for our security over the long run. But over the long run, and we can't expect immediate results. The second way that I would answer that question a little bit more specifically, you know, in terms of the oligarchs and the governors and the heads of Russian regions. It's really difficult to say. I think there are a lot of competing and contradictory factors that would come into play. You know, if you look at the oligarchs, just to illustrate some of the competing factors, in the mid-1990s, when this battle over the pace of reform was playing out, it actually split a lot of these people, the oligarchs, because they had different commercial interests. And there were some people for whom it was really important to get a lot of Western investment, you know, like in the banking sector or the financial services sector, because it was really undercapitalized. They didn't have enough money to be doing the things that they needed to be doing. And the only way to do that is to open up to the West and to have, you know, kind of a relatively friendly foreign policy. There were some other people who were in turning back to the energy complex, who weren't nearly so eager for foreign investment, and particularly were not eager for other people to have any control over the flow of money that they were using, you know, for whatever different personal purposes they found it to be convenient. There's a little bit of a tension. And, if you look at it a society like the United States, you know, you actually have the same kind of tensions. There are some businesses, actually, you look at Europe too, like, maybe I'll get myself in trouble in Kansas, but agriculture, where, you know, in I'll use France as an example, maybe instead of Kansas, where, you know, there's a real tendency towards a protectionist approach. And there's a desire, you know, for very legitimate reasons to support that industry and allow it to thrive and compete globally and not to die out. There are a lot of other industries, you know, that have a very different view and kind of want everything, you know, to be totally open. I'm not so sure with the oligarchs. Another thing about the oligarchs is, you know, a certain number of them have gone through what I would call sort of deathbed conversions in terms of their commitment to all of the noble goals that they espouse while they're in jail or while they're in exile in London or in other places. And if you actually look at what they were doing, you know, the case of Hodorkovsky is a little bit different, actually, because I think he was making some real efforts to run a clean company, at least for a couple of years. He had some political ambitions that got him into trouble. But before those last couple of years, there were some very unpleasant things that happened that allowed him to be in control of that company. And certainly with a lot of the other oligarchs, the same thing was true. And they kind of realized at a certain point that their relations with the Kremlin were deteriorating to such an extent that they needed another ally, and Washington was the best one. And everybody knows what, you know, people in Washington want to hear. So I think there's a certain element of that. The governors, looking at foreign policy, I think have an opportunity probably to play a more positive role because unlike the oligarchs who are kind of divided, they are people who really want to get money into their regions and they want to develop relationships and get investment. And, you know, it's that kind of commercial relationship, I think, that can establish a much more stable relationship with Russia. We have a complicated relationship with China, but our relationship with China within certain parameters is pretty stable. And it's pretty stable because we have really enormous mutual commercial interests. And it would be very damaging to our economy to have too much of a problem with them, and it would be very damaging to their economy to have too much of a problem with us. We're not there yet with Russia, and I think the long-term hope would be that that's where we get.
Yes, your last comments were leading to what I was going to ask about, and that was the impact of the apparent, at least, warming of relations between China and Russia and the impact that has on all this, and particularly in the oil and gas, Putin, and they're spending a lot of time together.
That's right.
And I hadn't heard much until right here at the end. I was just wondering your thoughts on that impact.
I'm a little skeptical of that, to be honest. And a few of us were talking a little bit about that line of argument beforehand. And, you know, looking at the energy resources and Russia and China, Russia is very reluctant to be too dependent on anyone in terms of exporting its energy resources. And when you build a pipeline, you become very dependent on the person who's on the other end of it. I mean, they're depending on you, but you're also very much depending on them. And because of that, I think Russia has a certain reluctance in getting too committed to China. They would much rather be selling, the gas to us or the Europeans because they see it as less likely that it will become a problem in the relationship. And they kind of like to go to China and to make a big show about how they're going to do this with China. I think to a certain extent it's a little bit directed at us. I also think that, you know, these agreements that they sign there's a long way between having an agreement and having a pipeline. I would consider, I used the phrase before, you know, it's the end of the beginning rather than the beginning of the end, you know, in terms of really seeing that kind of energy relationship between Russia and China. And getting back to the points that I was making earlier about Central Asia, you know, Russia doesn't want the United States nosing around in Central Asia, but they certainly don't want China doing it either. And that also creates a certain amount of tension in that relationship.
Russia's relationship with Iran, I'm kind of perplexed why they aren't being more aggressive with Iran. It would seem like Iran has a lot of potential to influence Central Asia and has a lot of ability to grow in terms of their power base. Why isn't Russia being more aggressive?
Aggressive in which sense? In the sense of trying to contain the nuclear program?
Well, that certainly is a thing that's in the news now. Mm-hmm. But I guess, are there other things that Russia is doing in terms of trying to control Iran?
Well, you know, the thing about Russia, and I'll again have sort of a multi-part answer. You know, we have a very particular view of Iran in the United States because we have, you know, the history of the hostage crisis. We don't have diplomatic relations. Most of the communication that we have with each other is through the media and not particularly friendly. Russia and Iran have a different relationship, and Russia actually sees Iran in the region as generally a constructive player. There was a civil war in Tajikistan in the early 1990s, and Russia and Iran really worked together to contain and resolve that. That's a big positive from a Russian perspective. Iran could have been trying to export its particular version of Islam in Central Asia and has not been. And, you know, that's certainly something that Moscow welcomes and doesn't particularly want to see change. Now, on the narrower question of the nuclear deal, I think there are sort of two different dynamics at play that make it very much in Russia's interest to try to allow the status quo to exist for as long as possible. And just to kind of quickly do the two reasons. The status quo gives Russia the opportunity to try to kind of play both sides, to get themselves a good deal. And the good deal that they want has two components to it. You know, component number one is to be reprocessing Iranian nuclear fuel in Russia rather than having it happen in Iran, which would allow Iran to have a complete nuclear fuel cycle and potentially get nuclear material to build a bomb. You know, they want to try to do that, and they try to do that by telling each of us that the best solution to this dispute is for them to reprocess the plutonium rather than having it done in Iran. The other problem is a strategic one, which is that no matter which direction the U.S. dispute with Iran goes in, it's a loser for Russia. If we get a deal with Iran and the United States can improve its relationship with Iran and European and American companies can start going into Iran, it's a major loss of influence for them in really the predominant power in that region. On the other hand, If we're not able to find some kind of a deal and, you know, we get so frustrated in the United States that we decide to try military action, you know, then they worry about Iran being destabilized. They worry about a new regime in Iran that could have a different attitude toward them, and they worry about a lot of other things. So they have a very strong motivation to continue negotiating as long as possible. And I think that's what we're going to see happen.
We have time for one more question, if anyone has one.
I'm wondering whether you could talk a little bit about how the American policymakers could deal more productively with an uncomfortable pattern that occurs in Russia, namely that the choice of leaders and policies that we consider to be undemocratic might actually be, in a sense, democratic in that they enjoy widespread majority support within Russia.
Yeah, you know, that's really a fundamental problem. And, you know, I'm glad that you raised it. It gets a little bit to the point that I was making about people having different perspectives in different places, and the Russians want different things from their leaders than we want from our leaders. You know, this is a person who enjoys upward of 70% approval in that political system. And, you know, a lot of people don't like it, and they can't really explain it in ways that are pleasant necessarily for them, but it's true. You know, he's certainly benefiting from high oil prices, by the way, because, you know, it's allowed him to do all kinds of things that Yeltsin could never do, to, you know, pay all of the salary and pension arrears that I was mentioning, you know, to be raising salaries of government workers, and you know there are just a lot more possibilities when you have more money, and that helps a lot. But you know, ultimately, you know, obviously Russia's not a democracy. But if we want Russia to be a democracy, or if we want anybody else to be a democracy, you know, we kind of have to let them make their own choices. And we also, you know, need to think maybe in some cases about, you know, is the act of voting really the core part of being a democracy? You know, I made the point before about checks and balances. You know, if I had to choose, you know, between Russia where people vote, you know, and you kind of have the system where you have now, and a system where there were checks and balances, but maybe there was a little bit different kind of political arrangement, you know, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I think from the standpoint of American interests around the world, having Russia that is kind of constrained a little bit in its decision making by processes, you know, is something that can be quite valuable. You know, we also I don't want to stray too far off topic, but you know, look at what happened in the Palestinian Authority. Was that really, you know, a situation where it was a good idea, you know, to be pressing that hard for, you know, elections to take place? And why were we surprised that was how it turned out? So, you know, the question of democracy and foreign policy, you know, I think it's an enormously complicated one. And I think it's one that we have to approach just very, very carefully. There are a lot of societies that, you know, we get an election or we get two elections or something, and then, you know, we think it's a democracy when that's far from being the case. Those societies, you know, people may vote once or twice and then they don't vote again for 20 years. The kinds of societies, at least in my view, that become sustainable democracies are the ones that really build institutions, you know, before turning people loose with this right to vote. If you don't have institutions so that people in a society can work together and you just go and tell everybody to vote, you know, in most societies, you know, I mean, look at some place like Yugoslavia. You know, people divide up on ethnic or religious or whatever lines, and you know, you get these very hostile dynamics that start to play out. If you have institutions first, then I think you have a much better chance. I mean, look at a country like South Korea. South Korea was a very unpleasant dictatorship for a long period of time. But, you know, they kind of slowly and gradually built institutions. And then they got to a point where, you know, the leadership was kind of ready. And, you know, I would consider South Korea to be a very vibrant and stable democracy today. So, you know, I think that's something we really need to think long and hard about in our foreign policy.
Please join us in thanking Paul Saunders for his presentation and for coming.
Thank you all very much. It really was a pleasure.
Okay, Paul. Thanks so much.
And